This is the ultimate PS3. It is an original backwards compatible model, meaning that it has a physical PlayStation 2 chip inside of it, allowing it full backwards compatibility with PlayStation 2 games. Throughout this video, I'm going to do some general maintenance and upgrades on this PS3, and I'm going to give you my opinion on whether or not you should buy one of these in 2024. I bought this thing off of eBay for a relatively good price, and the first step was to unbox it. Okay, so, unboxing time. Just got delivered. Smells weird. Power cable. There she is.
PS3!
Oh, this thing's heavy. This thing is literally 3 months younger than me. 3 months. Of course, after the unboxing, the first step was to turn it on and make sure it works. Alright, now the time.
First boot.
Oh, okay, we got a power line. I'm stupid, never had PS3. All right, first boot, here we go. Okay, now. Okay, well, she booted, but the problem is I don't have a connector that looks like that. Now that it's confirmed working, on to the fun stuff. I have to open the PS3 up, but this turned out to be a little bit harder than I was anticipating. Okay. So, this is a 1 terabyte hard drive. The person that I bought this from put this in here. After like 30 minutes of trying, I finally got the side panel off of the case. The faceplate is bent, warped. It looks like almost somebody took like a heat gun to it or something. Now we have to be very careful because we don't want to rip the ribbon cable. And we have successfully taken the top off. So far, it actually really does not look that bad. Oh, it just comes. Oh, be very careful. It didn't go in there. Remember, evenly removing the screws on the CPU and GPU will take most of the load off, hopefully not damaging it in the process. Dude, look at that. It's literally solid and there's none left.
1 eternity later.
Now, I didn't know this, but during recording, my camera shut off before I got to show the thermal paste application, but all you have to do is put a dot on the RSX in the CPU, and I like to manually spread it out with the applicator tool that I was given in the box. You don't have to do this, it's not necessary, but it can save you a lot of headache in the future. Alright, so something's wrong. Something's really wrong, and I don't know what it is, but I think it could be, it's got to be some kind of thermal pad, thermal issue. Okay, so my problem right now is the fact that there's something wrong with the mounting pressure on, I think, the RSX. The CPU is fine. You can see where all the thermal paste has been balled up and whatnot. Over here, the edge of this looks fine. You can see where it's scattered. But this corner right here, when I first opened it up, it was just exactly how I had spread it out. Like, it hadn't even been touched. It wasn't making contact. I tried bending the little things that hold it. Yeah, I tried to put a thermal pad there. To fix it, and that still hasn't worked. All right, so I fixed it, or at least I think I fixed it. I haven't turned it on yet. What I think I've done here that I might have fixed it is there's something called an eraser mod where people take little pieces of Magic Eraser and they knead it into the back of the CPU because there's a divot in the motherboard. But I didn't have one of those. So of course I thought, why not just use thermal pads? So using my 2mm thermal pads, I cut one to fit perfectly into the back of the hole that the CPU creates in the motherboard. And then I laid another 2mm one above that, creating 4mm of thermal pad and massively increasing the mounting pressure and slightly adding some more thermal conductivity. And from what I can tell, that fixed the issue. Remember to like and subscribe if you made it this far. I installed custom firmware to control and monitor the fan speed as well as the temperature of that CPU in the RSX, and so far it seems to be working flawlessly. That being said, something that I didn't do in this video that I will have to do in the future is de-lid the RSX and the CPU. That is because between the die where the actual CPU and GPU is located, there is a heat spreader in between, which is the metal piece that you actually put your thermal paste on. And in between that, there is a layer of thermal paste. Again, it's just as dry and crusty as the stuff that on top of it was. This means that over time, just replacing the thermal paste on top of the CPU and increasing mounting pressure won't actually do anything. But the reason I haven't done this today is because I have no experience with it. And there's a really, really high chance that on your first try, you're going to break whatever PS3 you try to delid. And one final note. I'm gonna have to take it apart again, because my Blu-ray drive, something's messed up with it. It reads games just fine, but the gears inside have slipped and misaligned, and so when going to put a game in or take a game out, it can't do it all the way, and takes multiple tries and makes some really, really weird noises while I'm trying to get it out. Now, the last upgrade that I did to this PS3 is kind of controversial, and I wasn't entirely sure whether I wanted to do it or not, but I installed an SSD. See, when I bought the console, it came with an upgraded 1TB hard drive, which is great. But because none of my games are digital, for now, the storage size of the drive really does not matter to me. And because I had a 256GB SSD just laying around, I put it in my PS3. Which, shockingly, was way easier than I thought. All you have to do on these earlier models is replace the hard drive, the firmware stays installed, you don't have to do anything else. You just have to re-download whatever games are installed to it, your saves disappear unless you manually back them up, but I didn't do that because I don't have any saves. Now online, there's a lot of people that argue for and against this. You see, the PS3 is equipped with a SATA 1 drive interface, meaning that realistically it only has a maximum bandwidth slash write and read speed capacity of 150 megabytes per second. Modern SSDs can blow that out of the water, meaning that installing an SSD, you won't see the full benefit that you would on a more modern system. Second, there's been various reports of people using some SSDs on the PlayStation only to come out with errors, slow read and write speeds, and just worse overall performance. But for my purposes, this cheap Kingston A400 drive works for me. Although eventually I want to upgrade to a 1TB SSD with an actual DRAM cache, because cacheless SSDs are not only slower but last way less long, which is why this model was so cheap. But that being said, this SSD really brings the PS3 back to life. It isn't really the biggest difference in the world, and maybe some of it's the placebo effect, but the overall responsiveness of the system is massively improved. The menus load faster, the transfers and the installs go way faster, and overall, games load faster. And the real thing that pushed me over the edge to try the SSD out is in a game like Dead Island, which I've really been enjoying playing recently, it stops something known as texture pop-in from occurring, where the game is already loaded but some of the textures aren't, so you get really low-res pre-models before the actual game happens. And maybe some people who are still playing PS4 in 2024 will know about this, is if you load into a Warzone match or Fortnite, you might see some of the textures not actually be there until you're looking at them for a good second and then they just randomly pop in. And an SSD allows this to happen basically instantly just because it has such a good random read and write speed, which is the thing you need for gaming. But overall, do I recommend buying a backwards compatible PlayStation 3 in 2024? Well, yes and no. See, I love this PS3, but I don't really have any PS2 games that I actually want to play or that I even own at this point. Do I recommend a PS3 in 2024? Absolutely. This is an amazing console with a bunch of fantastic games that I have never gotten to experience, considering the model that I have is literally 3 months younger than I am. But if you're willing to put in the extra cash, the extra time and work to make sure that it doesn't fail, and you actually have some use for the PlayStation 2 functionality, because remember, all PS3s can play PS1 games, then absolutely go for it. Alright, this video has been really fun, and it's been a huge deviation from the majority fitness content that I've been creating. If you enjoyed this video, please remember to leave a like and subscribe for more content. Thank you for watching.